Choose life. Choose a job. Choose a career. Choose a family. Choose a fucking big television. Choose washing machines, cars, compact displays and electrical tin openers.
What we just witnessed is arguably the most iconic opening scene ever created. It belongs to Danny Boyle's 1996 film Trainspotting. Chronicling the heroin misadventures of Rent and his group of friends, this movie has become one, if not the prime example, of the heroin chic cultural movement. The movie's portrayal of addiction connected with audiences all over the world. But what makes it so unique are its deeper reflections of the human condition and the ideologies it encapsulates. Take this scene for example. Renton's speech is about expressing anti-consumerist and anti-middle-class values. This rhetoric is the main focus of this video. What different critiques does Trainspotting really capture? As mentioned, the content of Renton's speech is firmly anti-consumerist. This anti-establishment sentiment is also reflected in the origin of the rant itself, being a parody of the Scottish anti-drug advert of the time. The rebellious aspect of the rant is again underpinned by the use of Lust for Life by Iggy Pop, a famous counterculture song. The song's rhythm also adheres to the coolness of the scene, and therefore creates an easier reception for the audience. Counterculture being a culture whose values and norms substantially differ from those of mainstream society. Another aspect of counterculture is its heavy referencing of popular culture. Trainspotting, for example, alludes to bands such as the Beatles or the film A Clockwork Orange by Stanley Kubrick. Furthermore, Renton's first-person narration, where he directly speaks to the audience, gives the scene a more personal touch, adding gravitas to the film's message. His rejection of consumerism can also be seen in his rejection of homogeneity, exemplified by the opposing football team wearing matching jerseys, while he and his friends are all individually dressed. They believe it is good to be different and form a bond over the rejection of consumerism. The monologue also expresses how our consumerist tendencies are often presented to us as a reason to continue living our conventional lives. But
who needs reasons when you've got heroin?
This reinforces the film's notion that just like heroin, mindless consumerism works as a stimulant in the pursuit of meaning. So, that heroin chic we talked about, what is it? Characterized by pale skin, emaciated features, and androgyny, heroin chic was a style popularized in the early 1990s fashion. The Los Angeles Times described it in a 1996 article as a nihilistic vision of beauty. What makes it inherently countercultural was its desire to break with the healthy look of the 1980s.
Fashion photos in the last few years have made heroin addiction seem glamorous and sexy and cool. That is not true.
This brings us to the second message of the movie. Its critique of the use of anti-consumerist rhetoric to escape personal responsibility. The death of baby Dawn removes the veil of coolness which permeates the previous scene and demonstrates that careless behavior leads to consequence. This scene in the movie is a critique on the use of nihilist anti-consumerist theory to rationalize narcissistic and irresponsible behavior. The characters were too focused on their own needs and desires to fulfill their responsibilities. The forward-tracking movement used to show the flat underpins how there is no reaction to the pain and suffering of Allison at first. The narcissism is also demonstrated by Renton's first thought not being related to the baby's death, but to the improbability of his fatherhood. This carelessness and neglect lead to the death of baby Dawn, which is a metaphor for the general consequences their nihilistic ideology entails. Renton feels no empathy, which is exemplified in him shooting up immediately after what has happened, and claiming the first shot for him.
And she got hit, but only after me. That went without saying.
He is literally putting himself before others. In this frame, we see the baby being trapped between linear play, imprisoned by the carelessness of the ones supposed to be its caregivers. All of this being the film's way of telling us that ideology does not absolve one of consequence. Finally, we can see the movie come full circle when it is revealed that the opening shot, chronologically, happens after the baby's death. This revelation, paired with a different presentation of the scene, further subverts the meaning of it. Renton's monologue has changed. The previous coolness and youthful rebellion is gone, and has made way for cynicism and destructiveness.
Ourselves with longing towards the day that it would all go wrong. Because no matter how much you stash or how much you steal, you never have enough.
The different musical choice for the scene, that being Sing by Blur instead of Lost for Life by Iggy Pop, also gives the scene a more depressing tone. The characters have stopped acting out of ideological principle, and now act out of selfishness and the need of
fucking people over.
One example of the selfishness can be seen in Sick Boy hiding away and leaving his friends up to their fate. One way of displaying this change in character of a protagonist is their reflection in the mirror. Their distorted bodies show that they as people have changed. In this iteration of the chase scene, we can see how the behavior of the characters affects others. Through the use of long shots instead of close-ups, we are made aware of how their recklessness negatively affects those around them. The reveal of the man who has hit Rent with his car and his shocked facial expression underpins this. Within the monologue, Renton also mentions his desire for things to go wrong, giving the car crash and him getting tackled by the policeman further meaning. The consequences have not only happened, but affected everyone and left them changed people.
And despite what you may believe, there is no such entity as victimless crime.
In conclusion, Trainspotting can be read as a critique on Western consumerism, using its characters, narrative, soundtrack, and cinematography to reinforce its message. But it also makes a statement on the use of ideology as a shield to protect from the confrontation with responsibility. The characters might start off rebelling against society, but have to find out that they cannot live their lives outside of consequence. This realization leads to a loss of their idealism and firmly places them within cynicism and destructive behavior. We can therefore confidently say that the filmic techniques employed in Trainspotting underpin the critique on Western consumerism, as well as the use of nihilistic anti-consumerist rhetoric to rationalize the characters' narcissistic and irresponsible behavior. We really hope you enjoyed this video and found it insightful. What?
Whatever you say, man, sorry. You're the man, the dude in the chair.
No, it's not bad, but it's not great either, is it? It's actually just shite.